Ambassador Majid, and I would like to recognize the Prime Minister of Namibia. And as a matter of introduction to what I will say later, say that I have personally a high admiration for Namibia's position on the necessity for Africa to increase its internal resources mobilization. So, but a way of introduction and recognition to Commissioner Ibrahim, my dear brother Abdallah Hamdok. Africa has put its house in order by framing PIDA, which is the Program for Infrastructure Development in Africa. There was a, before PIDA, we had institutional chaos, non-prioritization, and a lack of total coordination, After PIDA, which was a bottom-up process, we have now a long-term strategy, a pipeline of projects, prioritization, and an institutional framework with a differentiation of roles for the implementation of PIDA. So as a transformative long-term strategy, PIDA will require critical policy decision at national level to leverage long-term institutional investment funds, such as those managed by insurance companies, pension funds, and sovereign wealth funds. So the choice to gravitate towards institutional investor funds, away from traditional bank syndicated debt structures, is the result of increasingly belt tightening regulations imposed on commercial banks under Basel III bank supervision rules following the 2008 global financial crisis. This gravitation is further evident by the dominance of institutional investment funds in the global basket of assets under management, AUM. So if we look at African pension funds, Africa's pension funds and sovereign wealth funds are said to be growing steadily despite their nascent state. Current estimate of market capitalization of 10 pension funds in Africa stands almost at $380 billion, according to data from the Boston Consulting Group, with South Africa accounting for 85% of it, or $322 billion of a total market share. And the other African countries with growing pension pools are Namibia with $10 billion, Nigeria $6 billion, Ghana $2.6 billion. When Norway's pension funds or US pension funds invest wherever they want, it's a good thing. But African pension funds should start by investing in Africa. That's the best message they can send to the other institutional investors. So the emergence of infrastructure as an economic enabler for growth and job creation in Africa has created the opportunity for institutional investors who have more risk appetite in search for higher yields to invest in new assets class such as infrastructure that provides long-term cash flow stability and return on equity. So unlocking such long-term investments for Africa's infrastructure foremost would need a predictable legal framework, free of regulatory constraints, to mitigate the inherent risk attuned in the continent, political, regulatory, commercial, operational. And given the liquid nature of the institutional investment landscape, pension funds in particular can be leveraged to finance Africa's infrastructure through several undertakings, which I will mention. But don't mistakenly think or take what I would like to say. I profoundly believe that a key actor will be the state, a development state with a clear view of what it intends to do in implementing infrastructure. We should move away from a situation where regulations didn't exist at all, or the deregulation was the principle that was imposing itself, and rethink the role of the state as a development state. So the first undertaking should be about overcoming regulatory constraints. And we know that private investment, particularly in Africa, is constrained by the lack of an enabling and legal and regulatory framework. As interim CEO of the African Peer Review Mechanism, I can say that this is an issue that we look at very carefully. Hence, a robust, transparent, and predictable legal framework is needed in order to unlock private investment for Africa's infrastructure development. We have just established 1 month ago with the African Union Commission what we call a continental business network. And the role of that continental business network will be to serve as a space of dialogue between investors, between regional economic communities, governments and countries, evidently, and also with other non-state actors on the continent, like the Pan-African Chamber of Commerce, who are playing a critical role. A second undertaking, the infrastructure bonds. Infrastructure bonds are increasingly being used in Africa to finance national and regional infrastructure projects. A case in point is the diaspora bond issued by the government of Ethiopia to finance the Great Millennium Dam project currently under construction. And given the long-term view of infrastructure bond vis-a-vis the need for stable cash flow and a future return on investment, such financing instruments can be used to leverage project finance cash flows. And lastly, listed PIDA SPVs. Given the growing African capital market and the increased appetite of key strategic investors, such as institutional investors, in order to diversify their portfolios, listed special purpose vehicles are being studied to unlock long-term debt financing for the development of key strategic PIDA corridors. In conclusion, what all this means is that Africa has the potential to finance its own development if such long-term and growing debt and equity instruments are well managed under a robust, transparent, predictable regulatory environment where investors have access to the same information and regulatory interpretation of the rules of the business. Thank you.